Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the opportunity to present my paper about the feasibility of endoscopic management of an anastomotic leakage in the critically ill patient. I don't have any conflicts of interest and I don't have any disclosures. So every year over 440,000 patients die of esophageal cancer each year, despite improved diagnostic and treatment modalities. And an esophagectomy is still the cornerstone of curative treatment, either an open or a minimally invasive technique. And in the last decade, a minimally invasive esophagectomy is gaining popularity, especially due to a reported lower postoperative morbidity and mortality rate. And this is one of the studies from Beer et al. Who showed a shorter hospital stay and lower pulmonary infection rate after minimally invasive esophagectomy. However, an anastomotic leakage is still a feared and life-threatening postoperative complication even after the minimally invasive technique, with an incidence of 5 to 25% and a mortality rate of 20 to 40%. However, there is still no evidence-based protocol about how to treat an anastomotic leakage, and every hospital usually has their own protocols. And there are several treatment strategies ranging from conservative, using antibiotics only and nil per mouth, or endoscopic treatment ranging from stenting or clipping of the leakage or suction drainage, to surgical techniques. And it's our what we see around us that if patients are critically ill, then the treatment tends to be more aggressive, often leading to more reoperations. And therefore, the aim of this study was to explore the role of an endoscopic treatment for critically ill patients due to an anastomotic leakage after an esophagectomy. In order to investigate this, four hospitals gathered information about their esophagectomies, and these are regional referral hospitals for patients with esophageal cancer in the Netherlands, and they're all high volume, meaning they all perform over 40 esophagectomies every year. And all the patients included in the study were treated between January 2012 and September 2016. And these are the four hospitals from the three different cities in the eastern part of the Netherlands. All the patients included in the study had resectable esophageal cancer, and they all underwent neoadjuvant chemoradiotherapy according to the CROSS regimen, unless this was contraindicated. And afterwards, they all received a minimally invasive esophagectomy with intrathoracic anastomosis according to Ivor Lewis. Of course, all the patients developed an anastomotic leakage, and they were all readmitted to the ICU, so they were all critically ill. All the patients were divided into two groups regarding the primary treatment which was chosen at the diagnosis of the leakage, which could either be an endoscopic treatment or a surgical treatment. And the endoscopic treatment could consist of clipping or stenting of the leakage, or suction drainage, and that's a technique we use sometimes in Holland, in which we put a nasogastric tube in the cavity of the leakage in order to clean the cavity and so that the anastomotic leakage can heal. And on the right, you can see a CT scan of a patient with big mediastinal abscesses, which were successfully treated using this technique. The other patient groups received a primary surgical treatment, which could either be a VATS, a video-assisted thoracoscopy, or a thoracotomy, either to drain empyema or to seal the leakage. And the primary outcome of the study was the success rate, and success was defined as a clinical improvement after primary treatment. And let me give you an example. So if a patient underwent an endoscopic treatment and after a few days the patient got better and the leakage healed, then it was a successful treatment. However, if the patient got sick and developed empyema after the endoscopic treatment, then of course it was not successful. And in the surgical group, the same applies. In total, 83 patients developed an anastomotic leakage in this period of time, of which 57 patients were critically ill and were readmitted to the ICU. And these 57 patients were included in this study. And of these 57 patients, 35 patients underwent a primary surgical approach, and 22 patients underwent a primary endoscopic approach. all the basic characteristics of these patients, age, gender, ASA classification, CT and M states, neoadjuvant therapy, procedure time and blood loss were all similar. So similar groups. If we take a look at the characteristics of the leakage, we can see that the median CRP at the day of the leakage was similar in both groups, 235 versus 233 in the endoscopic group. Median leukocyte count was similar as well. In both groups, the anastomotic leakage was diagnosed at postoperative day 5. Empyema was seen in 33% of the patients in the surgical group and 23% of the patients in the endoscopic group. And mediastinal fluid collection were seen at similar rate as well. So the characteristics of the leakage were similar as well. And these are the main results of our study. We can see that median ICU stay was 14 days in the surgical group and 16 days in the endoscopic group. And median hospital stay was 43 days in the surgical group and 45 days in the endoscopic group. In both groups, the median amount of re-interventions was 5, and these were the radiological re-interventions, surgical or endoscopic re-interventions. And time to restart oral intake was 31 days versus 33 days. And oral intake was defined as thick liquids and more, so either soup or yogurt, etc. And the success rate was quite satisfying, 71% in the surgical group and 59% in the endoscopic group. And mortality was low in both groups. 2 patients died as a consequence of the anastomotic leak in the surgical group and 3 patients in the endoscopic group. So again, all the main outcomes of our study were similar. So in conclusion, we can say that an endoscopic treatment in the critically ill patients appears to be feasible. Of course, an anastomotic leakage always requires an individual and patient-tailored approach. However, given the satisfying outcomes and the minimally invasive character, we think that an endoscopic approach should always be considered. Thank you very much. Are there any questions?